Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rich Longo, and I'll be your host for today's presentation. I'd like to welcome all of you from throughout North America, as we have Canada representative and as far south to Texas, California, Louisiana, and over to Virginia. Thank you for joining us. We do have a variety of folks trying to still join us. So before we get started, let's get some introductions out of the way. First of all, welcome to today's presentation of What is Remedyforce, presented by Flycast Partners' own Rob Streeter. Rob is a recent software engineer that has recently joined Flycast Partners' team. He's been working in the ITSM space for well over 7 years now, and his roles have varied from software consultant with BMC Software to system administrator and ITIL process engineer with various BMC customers. Rob brings both experience and from the vendor side of things and from the customer side of things of ITSM, and has a wealth of knowledge about ITIL best practice and ITSM tool sets. Before we get started, Rob, let me introduce our organization. Flycast Partners is here to deliver a seriously amazing IT experience. Founded and staffed by personnel that have many years of experience in the IT space, we took the best ideas from these collective experiences and added the best components necessary to grow and become a leading value-added reseller in the North American IT market. We offer best-in-class implementation services and training in ITSM, ITAM, and WLA workspaces, including ITIL best practices. Our professional services can easily scale up or down in order to meet the IT needs of any customer, regardless of size, complexity, or budgetary restrictions. We offer implementation services both on-site and remote, as well as training to reinforce your company's long-term IT success. Our ongoing administration and support services offerings will enable your organization to focus on your normal day-to-day operations, saving your time and money. Please visit us at our website at www.flycastpartners.com, or feel free to reach out to us via phone at 844-FLYCAST. That's 844-359-2278. And this is just one of our many weekly webinars here at Flycast Partners. We encourage you to utilize our website for researching those industry white papers or data sheets that you've been wanting to look at, training that is available from ITIL to IT. ITSM tools, and assistance with professional services. Also, feel free to utilize our new ITSM solution finder. Now, today's presentation, we're actually going to be taking questions at the end. So I encourage each of you to take the time to type your questions in to us, and I'll read those off to Rob at the end of the presentation. We'll answer questions up until the end of our 45-minute time limit. So throughout the presentation, I encourage you to go ahead and forward your questions along. Now, Rob, what is Remedyforce?
Thanks for the introduction, Rich, and welcome everyone to today's session on BMC Remedyforce Service Desk. As Rich mentioned, I am Rob Streeter, software engineer here with Flycast, and let's jump in. So we're going to start this meeting off with a quick overview on BMC Remedyforce, and I have a few slides that I want to discuss in terms of what is Remedyforce, just so that you get familiar with the Remedyforce product and understand what it has to offer from a service desk perspective. From there, we're actually going to jump in and take a look at the Salesforce.com platform, the platform that actually hosts Remedyforce. So if you're not already aware, Remedyforce is a 100% software as a service solution, and it's hosted on that Salesforce.com platform. So we want to make sure that you understand everything that you need to know about the platform so that you're comfortable with where the solution is hosted. After that, we're going to jump into a Remedyforce product demonstration, talk a little bit about the self-service portal that comes with Remedyforce, and then go into the agent portal, talk about incident, problem, change management, and CMD. We're going to wrap things up with a dashboards and reporting session and then Q&A at the end, as Rich mentioned. So why do customers choose Remedyforce? Well, Remedyforce, as I mentioned, is a software as a service-based solution. And that plays a key role in that lower total cost of ownership that Remedyforce provides. So you no longer need to think about managing or maintaining any of that hardware in the back end, whether it be a server or database, things of that nature. All of that is going to be run and managed by BMC software and Salesforce.com in the back end. You won't see any of that stuff going on. Now, the other nice part about Remedyforce is it's quick time to value. And that's where all of the other points come in. So if we talk about quick time to value, what makes up quick time to value? Well, Remedyforce is feature-rich out of the box. It's intuitive and easy to use, so your agents and end users can get up and running and learn the tool very quickly and seamlessly. We provide seamless upgrades with Remedyforce, which we'll discuss in a little bit more detail later. Also, the administration and powerful integrations. And that's something that we'll discuss in more detail as we go through. Let's start off with some core capabilities and ISO processes that Remedyforce supports out of the box. So we're taking a look here at our screen, and you see a whole bunch of different processes and modules that we offer within Remedyforce. On our top row, you're going to notice our self-service portal, and that'll include things like service request management, so your end users can request for those services that you offer up to them. The knowledge management database, so the end users as part of that self-service portal can view those knowledge articles and help resolve their own problems themselves, reducing the number of incidents and calls that you get into your help desk, along with the ability, of course, to open up tickets, which is standard functionality that you can expect within a self-service portal. Now, all of that is wrapped up, of course, within your service level management agreements that you have set in place so that everything stays on target and your end users stay happy because you're resolving tickets in a timely fashion. Now, as we go down the list in further details, we'll take a look at our agent side where we start talking about our formal incident management, problem management, change management, configuration management processes. All of that, of course, within the Remedyforce solution is wrapped up within the ISO best practice processes, which comes within Remedyforce, and then our reporting and dashboards or real-time analytics that you can leverage within the Remedyforce solution as well. And all of this stuff is accessible via a simple web browser, so you don't need any client to be installed on any of your devices, nothing like that. Now let's talk a little bit about the ease of administration. So Remedyforce is a fully point-and-click development solution. And what I mean by a point-and-click development solution is all the coding is done by BMC Software and Salesforce.com in the back end to be able to go through and build your environment. Now, what you want the flexibility to do within a service desk solution is to be able to go through and configure that information so that it matches your needs. So you want to be able to go in and create custom fields, forms, workflows, approval processes. All of that fun stuff is all created via point-and-click development. So your administrators don't need to know any knowledge around any type of coding knowledge at all. Now, in addition to that, we have drag and drop analytics. So your agents can quickly and easily navigate and create reports and dashboards via simple drag and drop. They, as well, don't need to know any coding or any SQL to be able to run database reports, things of that nature. All of that is done via our drag and drop interface. Now, when we take a look at this screen, it shows the iteration of Remedyforce. So you can see since Remedyforce's inception in 2010, BMC has released 2 to 3 major versions per year since then. These are seamless upgrades to our customers. So these upgrades occur in the background. Our customers will get the new features and functionality, but they won't see anything that goes on in the background. There's a very limited downtime in this. I think the Salesforce and BMC is down to about 5 or 10 minutes, and that occurs typically during the weekend to be able to go through and get these upgrades in place for all of our customers. You can see these aren't just minor upgrades. They include a whole bunch of new features and functionalities that have been helpful for all of our customers throughout each of the releases. Now let's discuss the power of the platform and talk about the platform that's going to be hosting your Remedyforce solution, which is that Salesforce.com platform. So when you think about going into the cloud or leveraging a software as a service provider, you want to make sure that your environment is reliable, available, and secure so that you have the security measures in place. You know that it's going to be up and running when you need it. And this is where the Salesforce.com platform comes into play. Gartner ranks them as the top software as a service provider in the world. And you can see why right here. They have 99.9%+ uptime, and they have high availability servers and network equipment across multiple data centers across the globe with no single point of failure. So making sure that you're always able to access your environment when you need it. They also support multiple security certificates that you can see listed on the screen here below. As we go over, you can see all this information again at trust.salesforce.com. This is where you're going to find those security certifications, more information on the security best practice of the entire Salesforce.com platform, along with live system status updates, which you can actually see in my laptop on my screen here. And then, of course, historical performance information. And this is an open website for anyone to go through and access, and you don't need to log in or anything like that. And the last thing that I want to cover as part of our presentation from a slide perspective is the App Exchange, which is the number one business application marketplace in the world. And the App Exchange is essentially the iTunes store for your business applications on that Salesforce.com platform. So you can go through and jump onto this App Exchange once you're on the platform and download any of the 2,500 applications on that App Exchange, and I think there's more than that now, and you can leverage those. So right now you may be in need of an IT service management solution or service desk solution, but maybe sometime down the road you're going to be looking at a gamification solution to help your service desk, or you're going to be looking at a project management solution to help with your project management needs on that Salesforce.com platform. And all these applications have native integration to each other, and they're all accessible via one web URL. Now, without further ado, let's jump into the product demonstration and go through a couple of use cases.
As Rob is converting over to the Remedyforce tool, I would like to encourage those of you with questions to please take some time to type those questions in, and Rob will try to answer as many as he can before the end of our presentation today.
All right, perfect. Thanks, Rich. Now, taking a look at our Remedyforce solution, you can see I'm logged in here as an end user. My end user is John Smith, and he's logged into that self-service portal so he can try and come in here and help himself. The first thing that you'll notice is I have some branding up in the top corner here with Flycast Partners. The colors and schemas can be, all be changed to match your company needs. So this interface can you can make it look and feel however you need. Now up at the top, you'll notice our scrolling broadcast. This is where you can track any of your major incidents or issues that are ongoing in your environment and make your end users aware of those issues. Now, if I open up my broadcast window here, I can see additional details on any of those scrolling broadcasts that are going up at the top that are standing out to me, and I can go through and I can follow those, or I can submit an additional ticket on those so that I continuously get all the updates as that problem or that major incident is getting resolved. So I can see all that information directly from within the self-service portal. Now, as I continue going down, I want to run through a couple different use cases today. My first use case is John is having a problem with email, and he wants to go through the self-service portal, try and resolve his email issue himself via the self-help knowledge articles, but he also wants to go through and submit a ticket once he realizes he can't resolve the issue. So I'm going to start off going through and taking a look at our knowledge base. Now, Remedyforce supports two different knowledge bases, one knowledge base for the end users and one knowledge base for your internal agents. So you can segregate knowledge articles, maybe some of the simple knowledge articles that you want to make available to your end users, they can be available within self-service, and then some of those more complex ones we keep internal only, so your end users won't be able to see. You can see all of our knowledge articles are organized by category. I have a bunch of different categories here, so John can quickly and easily find his email category, or he can simply search up at the top email, and that'll bring back all of the different email knowledge articles that are created within the environment. So you can see, let's open up one of these knowledge articles and take a look at that in more depth. Now you can see that his knowledge article down here provides him with a little bit of information on tips and tricks on how he can resolve his Outlook mailbox. And you can see there's links and images included as part of its knowledge article, so it's fully rich text-based and includes all of that information. Now, if I scroll down to the bottom here, I can also provide that feedback for my knowledge manager within my self-service interface for a knowledge article. So I can let my knowledge manager know if my knowledge article was helpful or not. I can provide comments and feedback and submit that over. So my knowledge manager can then go through and review these knowledge articles and make sure that the knowledge articles are kept up to date and maintained. And without that in place, you won't ever know how your knowledge articles are really performing and if your users are really using those. So let's go back to the homepage and go through and submit a ticket as John Smith. So he wasn't able to resolve any of his issues, his Outlook issues within that self-service or self-help document, but he wants to go through and submit a ticket. Rather than calling the help desk, he's going to come in and create his own new ticket. So I'm asked what my category is. So John can go through and populate his category. He's having an email problem in this case. He'll go through and click enter on email, and he'll provide details on what's going on. I can't seem to type and talk at the same time. Now, these additional fields that are up here at the top, they will be populated once I click save. Now, I do want to mention I have two custom fields in here. I have this checkbox custom field and this drop-down custom field. And this really is providing the information to be able to go through and populate impact and urgency in my back end. So can I still perform my job and who is without it affecting? So you have the ability to be able to go into this form and configure it whatever way you like, whether you want to add new custom fields to this form, whether you want to remove fields from this form and make it more simple for your end users to populate. Now at the bottom here, I can also go through and attach files, so I can select my file and attach that file onto this ticket. Let's go through and submit that request, and you can see all of our information, John Smith and the number of the ticket and his email address have all been populated here within this ticket automatically. Now let's go back to our homepage and take a look at our service request portal, so our service catalog. You can see within my service catalog here, I have a bunch of different options for services that I provide out to my end users. So I have some employee or HR type of service requests here. And then I also have my mobile device requests along with a few others that are up there. I'm going to go through and request for a mobile device today. And you can see as I select that new mobile device request, I get a preview page that'll give me information on what my request is about. So within this request, I'm going to give the end user an option to be able to select the device that he would like to grab or would like to get as part of this service request. And I'm giving them information, I'm giving my end user information on that service request. You decide what you put on this preview page. You can include images, of course, and then all of the information that you need. Now within the service request itself, you'll notice I have a bunch of different questions, and these are configured based off of your needs and what type of service that you're offering. All of these questions are custom configured for this specific service request. So if I have other service requests, they're going to be asking my end user different questions as he goes through and requests for this service. So in this case, I'm going to select I want to order an iPhone, and I do want to transfer a personal number to a corporate number. So I'm going to select that checkbox. You can see I have a dynamic question built in off of that, and I can go through and now type in the answer to my dynamic question, what is my current number, so that my agent or technician can go through and resolve that or transfer that number over when I get my new device. And I'm also asking generic question of who my existing service provider is. So I can go through and select who that is and submit this ticket. Now, let's stay on this page for a second. You can see all the information is going to be provided within this page. So all the answers that John has gone through and answered on here, they're all showing up on the screen. But you can also see the information as part of the ticket down here. And this ticket specifically does require an approval process. So there's an approval in this case, and we'll talk a little bit more about that when we jump over to the agent side. Let's go back to our homepage. Now, one of the other common problems I get with some of my customers who don't currently have a self-service portal in their environment is, well, I'm getting a lot of calls into my help desk around ticket statuses. People asking me, what's my ticket status? What's an update on my ticket? Well, this self-service portal within Remedyforce also gives you the ability as the end user to come in here and view any of the tickets that you have open, see the status of those tickets, and even see information on that ticket in terms of what's going on. So I can see I have a few tickets opened. I had one earlier that I opened up, same mobile device request, and that one's been approved, but the new one that we just opened up now is still in the pending status. I can also open those up and see the ticket in full details. Now that we're on the subject of approvals, there are a couple different options to be able to go through and approve those requests. So in this mobile device example that we're talking about right now, my manager, who is the approver for this ticket, or John's manager, can simply come into the self-service portal and click on Manage Approvals, and they can approve that request directly from within there. So very simple to approve requests. Now, in terms of approvals, we also offer the ability to approve via email leveraging keywords. So my manager, or John's manager, will get an email notification letting him know that he needs to approve the ticket, and you can go through and reply to that ticket via email and simply approve it that way as well. And that works not only for service requests, but also for change requests if you're an approver on a change or anything of that nature. Now let's jump over to the agent portal and talk a little bit about the agent portal. So you can see if any of you are familiar with Salesforce.com, you're going to notice right away the agent portal has a very similar look and feel to Salesforce.com. It has the tabs up across the top that are listed. You can go through and edit those, which ones you see, which ones you don't want to see via this plus sign. Very simple to do. When we talk about Remedyforce, though, the core of what we're looking at is all going to be done within that Remedyforce console. So we have our views listed here, and our views pertain specifically to our different ITSM ticket types. So incident and service requests are listed here, and that's what I actually have open up in the background. I have my tasks, my problems, my change requests. If I open those up, you're going to see a completely different list, and this is listing only the change requests that are going on within my environment. So I have all these different ticket types that are all listed here, and they're quick and easy for me to navigate through, all within one major tab. Now I can break down my ticket types by different views down below, and these different views as well break it down further into really categories. So these are the different categories or keys that will go through and your tickets will be assigned to you. And you can have permissions set up within the environment to make sure that only the people who are assigned to those specific keys can only see those tickets, things of that nature. Now, if we take a look at the main screen, you'll notice the information here is very straightforward. It's very generic in terms of what's available on the screen. It gives your agents the overview of the ticket that they need so that they understand what type of ticket it is, what they're going to be working on, who the client is, things of that nature. The thing that stands out to me the most is the due date progress and the little streetlights, and that refers directly to your SLAs or your service level agreements. Let's go through and open up our service request that we submitted earlier and take a look at that in a little bit more details. You can see my information in here is very similar to what I can see within my self-service portal from self-service side, but I'm actually looking at it from an agent side, so I have access to edit and manage all of these different fields. I know that my client is John Smith, and he submitted a mobile device request, and I can go through and I can take a look at all these different tabs that I have here and all the fields that have been populated as part of this different service request. So Within these forms on Remedyforce, all of the fields are segregated by tabs, or what we call field sets within Remedyforce. And this is where our segregation of information really goes. And you can see I have different information in different categories or different tabs as we go along here. So I have some of my drop-down fields here, impact and urgency. I also have my priority field, which is being automatically calculated based off of that impact and urgency. I have some date fields down at the bottom, some configuration items, and then, of course, my queue fields and assignment fields for who's assigned and who's working the ticket from an agent perspective. Now, if we go up to the top, our service level agreements are going to be up here in this top corner. So I can open up my service targets, and I can see what type of agreements are associated to this specific service request. So in this case, I have an agreement. My agreement type is a generic SLA for all tickets. I have a response time and a resolution time. And that response time is 4 hours, and my resolution time, of course, is 2 days. So I can see that clock ticking. And now, from these SLAs that you can configure within the Remedyforce administration side, you can set up notifications and alerts and warnings as part of each of these things. So when I get down to maybe 1 hour left or 1 hour time remaining in my response time, I can set up an escalation rule to maybe email the agent's manager, the queue manager for that specific queue who's going to be working on that ticket. Now, if we take a look at the ticket in a little bit more detail, you're probably wondering, well, the form looks great and all, but where are all my relationships? Well, we hide our relationships over in the record details tab. So if we navigate over to that tab, you can see all of our relationship types. So our action history is actually going to be tracking where the ticket is coming from and where and information around that ticket. So if I have email communication going back and forth between my end user and this service request, my email information is right here, so I can email directly from within the ticket, and I can get a response from my end user directly within the ticket as well, and that information is all going to be tracked within my action history. Those email threads will all be tracked within me. Now, I also have an approval that we mentioned that we talked about a little bit earlier as part of this service request. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go through and approve that request, and you're going to see it auto-populate a few different tasks for me that are required as part of the service request. So I've gone through and I've approved this service request now, and you can see it's auto-populated those tasks for me. So the specific tasks that I have created within the service request, let's say, in order to provision a new mobile device to an end user, we need to go through and order him a new phone. We need to go through and create a service plan with one of our service providers and get that set up for our individual so that they can use that new phone and not have to worry about not getting a dial tone or getting a busy tone. So that's all part of that task within that service request, and that's all automatically created for you in the back end once we set up those different service requests. Now, as we scroll down on record details, you're going to notice we have linked knowledge articles, so I can link any knowledge articles to this record. I have my configuration items, change requests, problems, all of that stuff pertaining specifically to this service request, and all of those ideal as possibilities to be able to go through and relate. Now, if I would have attached a file within the service request, that would show up within my notes and attachment section. And you'll also notice down here at the bottom, incident tracking or ticket tracking for this incident, that includes any field updates or anything that's happened or occurred within this incident through its life cycle. And this is not something that's generic or standard for only incident management. This history section is something that goes across all of our different ticket types. Now let's go over and take a look at a problem. So we have our email problem that we have going on here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up that problem, and we're going to take a look at that in a little bit more depth. So as you're noticing, the form and the fields look fairly similar. Of course, these are problem management specific fields. not incident management specific fields, but these forms and fields, just like that self-service portal like we talked about, they're completely configurable. So you can go through and decide which fields you want to want displayed on your form, and you can decide how you want to organize that information, how you want to see it within this form. So taking a look at this problem, what I really want to do is I want to go over to our record details again and take a look at all the different relationships that I have created within this problem. So you can see I have multiple incidents that are related to this problem. So many people are having email issues, and I've related all those different email issues to this problem record. And you can see all those listed here within my ticket. I also have a change going on that's related directly to this problem request. And let's go through and open that change up. You can see, as I continue opening up different tickets, they're continuing to grow across the top board. So I can quickly and easily navigate back to the ticket that has been related to this specific one, and I can reference that very quick and easy. I can jump back to that problem with one click of the button. Now, coming and taking a look at our change management module, we have our change form, and our change form is going to be driven based off of the workflows. And those workflows or approval process are going to be driven primarily based off of your change type and your change category. So we look at the different fields on here. There's some standard change management fields like your reason details. So why are you going to be going through and filling out this change, a rollout plan, a backup plan, all of those standard change management fields that we'd expect to see within a service desk solution. However, our change types, here are the ones that we provide out of the box: emergency, normal, standard, and pre-approved. Again, similar to the forms and the fields, these are completely configurable. So if you have additional change types internally, you can add additional ones within there and have additional workflows in the background that are triggering on each of those different change types. Of course, our change categories can as well drive different workflows depending on what you select there. Let's go to our record details tab and take a look at some of the relationships. Now, when it comes to change management, I'm a very firm believer in you need a CMDB to effectively run a change management process successfully. And the reason why I say that is because when you look at change management, you're always changing something. You're always changing a configuration item, whether that be a server, a network equipment, a database, whatever it may be. You're changing a configuration item. So you want to make sure that it has that relationship within the ticket. You can see my linked problem is already created within here. I can see a problem opened up here, 000, and it's related to 03, and I can see that within my change request. And of course, my servicing configuration items, I can go through and I can open those up, and I can link additional ones here if I would like, or additional problems if I would like as well. So all of that is pretty straightforward in terms of managing your ticket. Now let's jump into the agent tool and take a look at our change schedule. So Remedyforce does offer a change schedule. It offers you a nice little legend up in the top corner if I open it up. So it gives you what type of change is going on based off of color, or whether it's a release. It'll show up on the screen as well in different colors, and you'll be able to see those. And you can see I have a few changes within my environment that are ongoing. What I really want to highlight here is the collision that's been detected between are two different change requests that are going on up here. So we, within the solution, are highlighting an additional risk as part of these two additional changes. And why is there additional risk? Well, this collision is pertaining to two different change requests that you can see are running at the exact same time, and they're associated to the same configuration item. So you have one or two different individuals who are going to be working on the exact same configuration item or changing the exact same configuration at the exact same time. So we want to highlight that as a collision and make sure that the change manager or requester are aware of that and they plan accordingly. Let's go back and take a look at our CMDB, and that's done through our agent tools within our change management. Of course, we have our Remedyforce CMDB tab, which will give you that list view of your configuration items, really more like an Excel spreadsheet. So we can go through and take a look at that. However, let's go through and do it from our change request and take a look at it from a visual standpoint. So And if I click on my CI Explorer view, you can see this change request 03 is related to my Houston mail service. Now, if I want to break that up into additional information on that, I can go through and double click on my Houston mail service or my mail application for Houston, and I can see what's making up that service. So I can see that that Houston mail service is made up by an application for mail in Houston. It's also made up by a database server and a database, along with a mail cluster over here and some network equipment, of course, to link everything together. So within our team view, we can see all of those different relationships between our configuration items. And of course, we can see that directly from the change request or the ticket, as long as the configuration item is related within. Now let's go through and talk a little bit about reporting and dashboards. First, I want to start off with our dashboards view. And I have an executive dashboard here that shows a whole bunch of information that's pertaining specifically to my executive. So high-level information, how many or what are the current major incidents that are going on, how many open priority one incidents, my incidents by SLA attainment, so how am I doing, am I on target, am I missing, I look like I'm missing a lot of targets here, that's not very good. And then of course, some different information around my ticket types that I have open within my environment and my change calendar, which we've already discussed and looked at. So within my executive dashboard, I have multiple views. So I have different dashboards that I can publish to different individuals. I have an agent dashboard here, which is a little bit more of a breakdown of different agent information and less high level. So it's more about that queue or that person's job and provides information around those types of tickets. So I have those different views that I have available. And of course, these are completely configurable views or personalizable views. And let's go through and edit some of these to see how easy it is to actually manage and maintain these dashboards and reports. So quickly and easily, I can jump into my dashboard here, and I have this funnel chart. If I don't have a preference for a funnel chart and I want to change that and make it more my style, I can go through and I can select that little wrench in the top corner, and I can decide what type of chart that I would like to see. I'm a huge fan of pie charts, so I can go through and select the pie chart, click OK, and I've now gone through and personalized that specific view or that specific dashboard there. Now, if I go down to the bottom here, I want to go through and add a new dashboard. So I'm going to click on my data sources. This is really straightforward. It gives me a list of all of the different reports that I have created within my environment. Many of these reports are out of the box. I can go through and decide which report I want to leverage within this dashboard and see information from, drag and drop that into one of my views here. Go back to my component and drag and drop my component, whether it be a pie chart or a graph chart, whatever that may be. Drag and drop that in there. Now, it's gone through and refreshed that entire view, and it's pulled back all the information pertaining specifically to configuration items within my CMDB. So I can see that information directly on my view, and that's how easy it is to really add additional information to your dashboard view. So very straightforward. All drag and drop. Now, if I click close and go back to my main dashboard view, let's go through and take a look at an actual report. So the easiest way I like to get to reports is actually clicking on the dashboard. So I can click on this open incidents by category dashboard, and you can see I've jumped over from my dashboard tab over to my reporting tab, and I get all my information down here. So I have all my different categories going on in here, and then all the information pertaining specifically to this report that I've gone through and pulled. Now again, fairly straightforward to be able to go through and manage your reports as well. And you can summarize or filter the information based off of information that's up here. So you have a couple options, one of them being category, different incident types, and then of course time frame, which is an option up here. In terms of really customizing and getting deep down into the weeds of managing your reports, you click on the Customize button, you'll jump into our Remedyforce reporting editor, and you'll be able to go through and configure this report fairly simply. So I have all my information down here. All I need to do is simply point and click, and it adds a new field that I need onto my view here or I can simply drag and drop that as well. So I can add that within there by simply drag and drop. Now, if I want to add a new filter to my report, I can, again, drag and drop into my filter section up at the top here, whatever field I would like to filter on, and I get the options of here's my field, what do I want to filter on, so is it equals to, is it not equals to, and then I'll type in what my response is or what my filter actually is going to be. I'll click OK, click Save, and run that report. It's really as easy as that. So everything within Remedyforce is all drag and drop. Now, when we talk about the administration, again, it's all drag and drop, and I mentioned that already as well. Let's navigate back quickly to the home page. The last thing that I want to mention before I hand things over to Rich for question and answer is our Remedyforce how-to guides that are out in the corner over here, and then our lineability process models, which we discussed within the slides as well. So, Rich, back to you for questions.
Great presentation, Rob. Thank you. And we do have a couple of questions. Our first question comes from Rick, and Rick wants to know, can the broadcast scroller be set up to change based on the user logged in, such as based on the user's organization?
Yes, of course. So the broadcast can be managed based off of account. And if I go over quickly to my broadcast section and open up one of my broadcasts, within the Remedyforce solution, you're going to create users, and you're going to typically set up different accounts for those users, and those accounts can be what department they work in, whatever you define within your environment. And then you can go through and, of course, select what that broadcast or who that broadcast displays to. So if I want to select only specific accounts, I can do that directly from within this broadcast.
Okay, and our next question comes from A10 Networks. A10, they want to know, can you do sub-ticketing with the Remedyforce tool?
Sub-ticketing. So sub-ticketing would typically be done either through broadcasts or tasks. So you would leverage the broadcast to do sub-ticketing with various incidents. So you have your major incident, a problem that's going on, or issue, outage, whatever you want to call it. That's going to be your broadcast. You're going to be carried over within your broadcast ticket, and that's then going to be in turn related to multiple incident records. Once your major incident or major issue is resolved, you'll go through and you'll close that broadcast record, and it'll subsequently close all of your different incidents. Now, we can also do a similar thing leveraging tasks, but I think this was more the question that you had.
Okay, and our next question, is the approval process integrated to other systems?
The approval process can be integrated with other systems. So within the approval process, you define what it does and what it calls. The approval process is typically built within, simply within Remedyforce administration, and it calls an approver, whoever the approver may be defined within the environment. So if you decide to integrate with Active Directory, it'll bring in those roles and those profiles from Active Directory, and it'll say your manager needs to approve. That's the type of approval that's been created in there. Now, if you want to create different rules within those approval processes or workflows that'll call APIs to different types of solutions, by all means, that can be created as well.
Okay, and a follow-up question from A10, and they want to know, can you track those sub-tickets?
Those sub-tickets will all be tracked within the record details section of your main master incident record. And then as well as within your incident console, you'll also be able to see that broadcast record related to all of your different incidents. So you'll be able to see if I open up one of those incidents, I actually have a broadcast field which will be populated. So you can simply and easily filter on that broadcast field to say what incidents are related to so-and-so broadcast or major incident, and you can bring all that information back.
Okay, and then we have from Open Technology, they want to know, can you show the workflow or escalation rule creation process?
Sure, not a problem. So let's jump over to our Remedyforce Administration tab, and we'll talk a little bit about our workflows. What I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly So this is an approval process, so I'm sure I have one that I can open up rather quickly. But you can see in terms of creating an approval process or even any workflows, it's all wizard-driven. So I have my wizard here, and I can go through and walk through all the different steps of the wizard that it provides. So my wizard with the steps that are part of my wizard, you can see them. I highlighted them up at the top of the screen. And that's really where you start going through and creating your different workflow approvals. And all the workflows are really all wizard-driven. Everything within Remedyforce is all done through point and click. So it's really straightforward to be able to get through and do those.
Okay, and Rob, I think that's all of our questions for today, and it's actually perfect timing. It's kind of ironic. Thank you for a great presentation. I really appreciate you putting this together for us. And for the rest of you that joined us today for Flycast Partners presentation, I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy days to join for this Flycast Partner presentation, and check out our upcoming webinars and join us. If you have any questions at all in regards to Remedyforce, the Remedyforce platform, please feel free to reach out to us at 844-FLYCAST, that's 844-359-2278, or you can email me at rich.longo, that's L-O-N-G-O, at flycastpartners.com. I will make sure that your email gets forwarded along to the appropriate person, and we will get an answer back to you within 5 business days. So once again, that's rich.longo at flycastpartners.com, or call us at 844-FLYCAST, is 844-359-2278. And with that, I wish you a great day.